Hi YouTube, this is Jigar again. Today we have a project we're trying to assemble to make the oxalic acid vaporizer that is fast and very reliable to use. There are other products out there on the market that kind of does a similar thing, but they're very expensive for an average, beekeeper. I don't keep a lot of hives. I have probably 20 or so hives. So for me, that product cost about $450 or more. And I can't justify that kind of cost for 20 hives. So I took up the challenge and basically try to make my own vaporizer. So this is for oxalic acid vaporization. So let's go over my design procedure and we'll try to do the assembly now. So let's get started. Okay, so we designed this whole oxalic acid vaporizer working backward. And our first part we started with was this this band heater. And I don't know if you can read this, but it's a 35 millimeter by 35 millimeter, 110 volt, 380 watt band heater. I bought it from Amazon, so that was the very first part we bought. And remember, don't go. So next thing we had to find out was what kind of a copper fitting or pipe will fit inside this band heater. So I went to Lowe's and I realized that there is a this is a copper coupling, forget the pipe for a second, is for a 1 1/4 inch water pipe. So this one has an outside diameter a little over 1 3/8, and the inside diameter is exactly 1 3/8 of an inch. So it kind of fit right into this band heater. So that was our second part. And then I'll come to the pipe in a second. The third part we ended up making is this one, which is an aluminum. This is our kind of a magic part, so to speak. This is the one that's gonna heat up significantly through this band heater and gonna hold up the heat. That's what makes this vaporizer work. So one of the key thing you wanna remember, this is a 1 1/2 inch stock of aluminum. We machined it, so this is about, I would say, 1 1/2 inch. I mean, you could just be a little more or less, it doesn't matter. But this recess we cut in is about a little more than halfway through. And that recess needs to press fit inside this fitting. Now, it doesn't press fit for me because I cut a little more. But if you're making it yourself, you can make it so it exactly does a press fit. Few more things on this stock. We drilled and tapped two holes. These are 1 1/4 by 20 NC thread machine screw. We tapped them. So the center one is for mounting this thing on a handle. We're gonna go over the handle in a second. And the second one is for the thermocouple. The thermocouple also happened to had 1 1/4 inch 20 thread pitch bolt or nut or combination of thereof. So we're gonna put that right here on the. So this K couple thermocouple is gonna read the temperature from this thing, so we can have a steady temperature. So that's that. So after we had this one, we can put the band heater on top of this. And we realized that if we put this, there's a hole drilled here, about 1/4 inch hole, that has another 1/4 inch pipe, a copper pipe. We bent it so just it clears this mounting bracket. So this is where the oxalic acid is gonna boil and sublimate, and it's gonna come out, the vapor's gonna come out this pipe. So that's that. The next thing we made was these Teflon caps. So Teflon caps, I bought a 2-inch Teflon stock off of eBay. This is about 1 inch. So you cut off 1 inch of a stock, put it in your lathe, cut a recess about a halfway that's gonna be snug, like a little, you know, that fits inside this coupling, copper coupling. And then we cut a little notch with a parting blade, so we can put an O-ring. This O-ring is a 1/8 of an inch inside diameter and a 1 1/4 inch outside diameter. And we also cut a little cup here. That's where we're gonna put the oxalic acid, put the cap in, push this in the hive, turn it upside down, tap it, boom, it's gonna start sublimating. We made two caps for this device. And so now let's go next in the handle. So the handle, I made it so we can mount this one onto this hole, which is a 5/16 of an inch hole. And then we have a couple of holes drilled and tapped to accommodate a number 1024 machine screw. And these are for mounting this relay, a solid state relay heat sink. Now, by the way, this solid state heat relay and associated PID controller, these are the kind of brain, so to speak, of this device. This PID controller is gonna make sure the temperature of this thing is kept at exact same temperature. You can start from 230 degree Fahrenheit and you can work your way up or down. But this one, you can buy it off Amazon. The model number is ITC106VH. And fairly simple connection. The number 9 and 10 gets a power, 110 volt AC. 6 and 8 is a control output for this SSR relay. And you're going to put a power in a serial to this output connector going into the band heater right here. And we're going to show you connection a little bit. And then the number 3 and 4, you connect your thermocouple, your K-couple device. So that goes between 3 and 4. And that's about it. So this, the hardest part about making this handle, this is just for stability. So when if we sit it down, it doesn't kind of wobble and topple away. The hardest part was this piece, man. This was a pain in the neck to make, because you had to get this opening just right so this PID control can kind of fit. We're gonna use this plastic mounting bracket that came with this PID controller. We're gonna mount that right here. So you basically only have two holes that you can drill that are very close to the edge of this thing. And man, I had to spend a lot of time making this thing. And then we welded it obviously on top of this handle. And then lastly, this wood handle we made was just a little wood stock we had lying around. We just, you know, jammed it in there. We drilled a hole and jammed right in. So that takes care of the handle. A couple of miscellaneous stuff. We made some Teflon washers to have this heatsink off of this handle, which is gonna get really hot. And also, we also put a spacer here, so when we mount this device, this heater block, we can keep it off. So the heat won't transfer to this handle and rest of the electronics that we're gonna have on this handle. So we got a couple of Teflon spacers. I'll show you when we assemble everything. But that's that. We're gonna start assembling everything, and if I remember something, I'll stop and add comments. But we're gonna fast forward to the assembly for the most part. When we come to the wiring connections, they're fairly easy. You just this number 8 and 6 goes to this SSR, which is a solid state relay, straight to that. 9 and 10 is just an AC power for this PID controller. We're gonna also need AC power going to this guy, and then there's a thermocouple connector between 3 and 4. So fairly easy connection. We're gonna kind of cover it as we go through, but we're gonna start assembling everything now. So we have calibrated this PID. Not exactly, I mean, I use the auto tune. The set temperature is 210 degrees centigrade and it overshoots all the way to 250, as you can see right now. We're gonna time this first batch. What I realized, if I have enough time to throw in another charge and let the temperature catch back up to 240, and that's when the best vaporization seemed to be happening. I might be wrong. 240 is what I'm going with right now. But first batch, when it preheats, you gotta start at 250. And then you have to keep the rhythm going. So every new charge, you want to put it between 230 and 240 and let it drop below the set point, and then that's when it's done. And while it's rising up to the temperature, you can start putting in the new charge. So in fact, you don't need the two caps if you are going with this design. So we'll get started. So I got my mask on. So you're gonna see me, hear me muffled. And we're gonna put this on. It's about at 235 right now. We're gonna start the timer. And I'm gonna start this charge. There's a very little kind of bubbled up material at the bottom. She started going down. The temperature is at 202 and going down. Alright, so now it's above 197 and that's about 30 seconds. So that's when the charge finishes almost to the completion. And while the temperature goes rising, you can get on with the next charge. So that, I'll let the vapor stop. So I think it's 30 to 40 seconds, and that should be finished by this time. So it's done. And while the temperature is 195 and rising, I can use that time to make another charge ready. Okay, as the temperature started climbing back up, we're gonna stop that and reset. And now it's about 230, so that's when you can get started. You don't have to let it overshoot all the way like we did. There, we started. So that's the, there's a lot of bubbled up material. So that temperature should start dropping at 225, 240, 222, 218, 216, 215, and it's over. As soon as it drops below 210, which is our set point, we should be done right at the 30 second mark, right there. So that was us, and now we take this thing out, put a new charge, a teaspoon worth. And while that guy shoots up, it's gonna shoot up at 230. So this is the time you can kind of reposition, go to the next hive, right? And as soon as your temperature goes to, again, 230, you're ready. See, the heating stopped right as it crossed 210, and it's gonna quickly climb up to 230. So you can get ready. And it's 223, 240, 230, and bam, you can start another charge. So 230 is about when you wanna kick this on. And as soon as you put it in, it's gonna start dropping and the charge is gonna start to work itself out. You see, it's still going out. About 30 second mark. Whoa. At about 30 second mark, we should be done, which is right there. See,
the temperature again under 200, and that's our kind of a telling that, hey, it's done. 40 seconds, I'll wait for 40 seconds just to be safe, right? Sometimes it's 30, sometimes it's 40. So we'll wait until the 40 second mark, and then we can take out this cap. I think that's it. We're gonna stop.